Good evening. My name is Fred Amon, and I'm the director of the Institute for Advanced Study. And I want to warmly welcome you to our lecture this evening. Thank you for coming out on a night made for movie makers, I think. A little bit of fog and atmosphere and everything else. We're very happy you're here. Before Professor Weidlinger introduces our speaker tonight, who I also warmly welcome, Pearl Gluck, thank you for being here. Let me just say a couple of words about the Institute. Many of you know a good deal about it, but perhaps some of you don't know much about it. Our Institute is dedicated to interdisciplinary studies, interdisciplinary conversations, and collaborative research. Our goal is to bring people to campus that sparks a conversation across disciplinary lines and helps bring together departments, schools, other centers, and have us share the wealth of knowledge and experience that is at this university, perhaps in new ways, because I'm sure as all of you have experienced from time to time, you don't always meet everyone, or even if you've been here a long time, you find yourself meeting in a conversation with people that you didn't know about. And our Institute tries to do that by creating opportunities for intellectual life outside the classroom and outside disciplines, really, in usual ways. And our speaker tonight certainly does that in multiple ways. I know that she's been in various classes and giving the lectures and talks and meeting and with students. Our Institute is dedicated to this endeavor that I've described on all 8 campuses. So when someone comes to Bloomington, they often will spend a little bit of time at least at one other campus. And I know that snowstorm, that there have been trips to South Bend, which are not easy this time of year with their Professor Pearl Gluck. We're really trying to bring the university together in different ways and provide different kinds of conversations. So those of you who think of someone that can spark that kind of discourse and spark that kind of conversation, please let us know. And our website has a lot of information about who has been here and who is coming, and also how one goes about nominating other fellows at our Institute. So thank you all for coming this evening. I'd like to introduce Professor Jeffrey Weidlinger to introduce our speaker tonight.
Thanks. Pearl Gluck is a internationally acclaimed film director. Yep, and acclaimed internationally. She began her filmmaking career while on a Fulbright year in Hungary, actually as the first Yiddish Fulbright recipient, the Fulbright Award, while pursuing a master's degree in folklore at NYU. She teaches Yiddish language and culture and literature at Rutgers University, and she became a filmmaker during this Fulbright year in Hungary. The results of that filmmaking career thing was this film, Divan, which on one hand is a film about a couch, but on the other hand is a film about a lot more. It's about the Orthodox Jewish community and about Pearl's own autobiographical explorations of the community from which she came from, and about the collection of folklore, and about Jewish folklore, Hasidic folklore, and Hasidic storytelling. Since then, she has made another film called Great Balls of Fire about a homeless fellow's dealings with September 11, and is currently working on another French film project about a walking tour through the Hasidic community of New York. She's here through an institute fellowship for 3 weeks to work on a Yiddish ethnographic project that Dov Bear Curler and I are working on. And in addition, she has been on campus giving various talks and speaking to classes and showing her film last night that many of you have seen. If you haven't seen it, and if you haven't seen it in other classes, you can still see it. It's available in the library, and it's available through numerous other venues as well. Today, she's going to be speaking about Two Steps Back, Uprooting the Auto Documentary, which is an exploration of the documentary film as a vehicle of self-reflection. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Pearl Black.
Thanks. I feel like I should introduce someone. Just keep making the rounds. We could do that, actually. I'm very impressed of the turnout that you guys come to evening lectures when you sit through it. Lectures all day. For me, this is a pleasure because not standing here, but going to one, because sitting in the editing room or just being in a setting where you don't actually get to think quietly while no one watches, they just think you're listening, is a real pleasure. So feel free to just sit and think and not necessarily listen to me, but just keep looking like you're listening to me. Nod your head every now and then. I will feel great up here. So thank you so much. I want to thank the Institute for inviting me here. I want to thank Jeffrey Weidlinger and Dov Bear-Carroll, not only for their work with AHAIM, but for welcoming me to be part of it. And I'm not only here in the presence of friends and colleagues, I'm also here in the presence of family. Apparently my great-grandmother's sister's great-grandchild is here. So if you could say hello, Mary, and just taking the two steps back immediately. So, okay. One of the things I was thinking of doing to start with is to maybe show the minute and a half or so trailer of Divan so you get a sense, and there's a lot less I would need to say. But has anyone who has not seen the film? So I think that it would be worth, right, popping, and then I have to talk less amount of time, which is perfect for me. So I don't actually know how to do this. That's part of the problem. So I'm going to figure that out right now. You know how to do this. Okay, so I'm going to give it to you. So as Jeffrey's setting it up, I will tell you a little bit about myself. I am currently working as a documentary filmmaker, I guess one can say for hire. But I am also open to talking to you about the industry if you're interested, how ideas come to fruition and onto screen or don't, as the case might be. And my next project is a short film based in Hasidish Williamsburg. And it seems like I'm focused on the Hasidim, and I am. And this one questions, I'd spent a little time in Poland, and I've always been thinking about the intensity of Polish-Jewish relations in the third generation. And we're talking about uprooting the auto documentary. Talk about uprooting and memory. I mean, it's not necessarily not connected, but it's obviously different topics. But uprooting this memory was kind of a daily experience for us. And by us, I mean my Hasidic family. I was brought up Hasidish. Because we would have Polish women come as cleaning ladies into our home. And you would see this incredible, for me anyway, once I look back, vision of the third generation Polish immigrant and the third generation Hasidic person. Now, what do you know about Hasidim? Does anyone know what I'm kind of getting at here in terms of that third generation, the purity of that third generation? Am I allowed to ask people questions? I've just done it. You have to speak loudly because they're recording it. And by the way, on the IIS website, it's amazing. You can actually listen to all of the lectures that were given in the past. So what is that connection? The third generation. Why am I specifically focusing on Hasidim? Not just because I'm from there. Any guesses? Well, what are the roots of Hasidism in terms of what you might know offhand? Just scream it out. Argentina? No. Ukraine, right? So we're thinking Ukraine, we're thinking Poland. Nobody knew that? Okay, so then survivors are coming from which country, more or less, coming to America? Poland and Hungary. I know some of you know that out there. So then their children, are they marrying out of the community? Generally not. I mean, we don't want to generalize, but generally not. So now you're getting the second generation, what we call pure. You can actually test against this. They are survivors' children, and almost the entire second generation. The third generation holds the same thing. My children, should I have gotten married within the Hasidic world, would have been pure tests against, if you wanted to test against other American Jews and how that kind of memory, like if you were wanting to know what might happen to other post-genocidal communities, you can actually look at post-trauma in the third generation of Hasidim. And, you know, this sounds like, okay, this, what does this have to do with narrative film? For me, it's always going to be rooted in some kind of look, not only at myself, meaning my community, but also the documentary issues around it, meaning looking at some of the sociological and even ethnographic reasons behind it. So this is a story about a Hasidic man who murders his Polish cleaning lady and gets away with it. This is true. And one might say, you know, and you do hear this talk a lot in African-American studies and actually almost any specific ethnicity study, specifically Jewish as well, the question of, you know, airing your dirty laundry. And this is not necessarily not about the auto documentary either. Can you really tell your story and complicate your identity at the same time? And who has the right to do so? And I know that it's very dangerous that I am picking up the camera and I'm going to tell this story, but I am going to ask a general question, which is how far does a community go to protect their own? So the Hasidic community actually protected the killer and hid him away in another country. I now know where he is, but I didn't know when I wrote the script. So this is my next project. It's going to be a short film that is not documentary, but it's documentary inspired. So that gives you a little background.
Everyone has a couch story, and this one is mine. Sort of. These are Rebbe's, and where I come from, everyone has a Rebbe story. And this is his, sort of.
I'm off the couch, right? The
people behind me. We all know the story of the couch. My father's been trying to get it out of Hungary for years.
The record dog is easy. He's a lot different.
You're gonna be for the couch. Since boy, nobody's done for the couch what you're gonna do for the couch.
My father had not gesagt, ob ich kann, bring den Divan. Ob nicht, vergess für den Divan. Ich hab schon fast.
You cannot have a couch instead of a guy. The couch cannot replace the Hasidic man at your side. Sit on the couch.
There's a little tremendous prevalence. If there's time to stand with me, you start it again. And you see.
Being between worlds is itself an incredibly fragile position to be in.
What makes you so Hasidic?
Why? Because that's why
I was
born up.
So I'm also
still Hasidic. I didn't know.
People look at me and say I'm not Hasidic.
I don't think he's doing it for a film. Because he wanted to do it to make a film, he would find a subject that would sell. I don't think this is a subject that would sell.
So that is a trailer to my first film. And what I'd like to do is take a second look for a moment at Hasidic storytelling in the context of lifting a camera and then turning it eventually onto the self. Can you think of various reasons why one would actually do that? Why would you take a camera and start documenting who you are, take a couple steps back, etc., and really tell your story? I mean, who actually, their stomachs turn when they think of that as a possibility? Okay, someone's not telling the truth, because mine certainly did. I mean, I think that there's a lot of rejection toward the honesty of self, almost the nakedness of self and the rawness of honesty. And let me try this again. Who here loves the idea of actually writing a poem that's totally about yourself, or your autobiographical essay, or, like I said, taking a camera and have someone follow you around all day? You love that idea. You're raising your hand. You're not raising your hand. In the yellow. Why?
Learn more about myself.
To learn more about yourself. I think I want to turn this off, if you don't mind. Maybe just pop it out or something. To learn more about yourself. Okay, excellent. So basically what you're saying is camera as witness, almost. Is it also camera as conduit? And then what's the difference? Anyone have an idea of why I would have thrown that word out? So there is a difference, because the camera is witness, you can actually be a biographer, right? You can witness with the camera, people do change in front of the camera and they begin to craft themselves. That has been my experience. But when you turn a camera onto yourself, are you crafting yourself? What tends to happen? And we all have this experience now because cameras are so cheap. What tends to happen when you turn the camera onto yourself? You're not necessarily crafting yourself. That might happen in the editing room. What? Yeah. It becomes something what we call self-conscious. And let me ask you something. Let's reconsider that word. What is wrong with the consciousness of self? And it's exactly why you said, that sounds great. I think I'll try that. Are you a filmmaker to be, or a filmmaker? No. You might think about it. So, I mean, it goes without saying, ever since the creation of the camera, the Lumiere brothers and various others who have come after have always turned the camera onto the self, but not necessarily, for some reason, has it been called autobiographical film. And later you would have people like Stan Brakhage, Jonas Mekas, you know, doing what I guess they would call art film that was autobiographical and forgivable for that reason, because it was art film, it was experimental. And finally, I think with people like Agnes Varda, who we're actually going to look at, and many others actually, it has become more and more acceptable, and probably even with the cheapening of the camera, not the camera itself being cheap, but that it's more and more available, it becomes more and more available to tell your own story. And the process of self-discovery through the camera is proliferating to the degree where it really is, and has been before, I want to reiterate that, it has been before, but it really has become a much more examinable genre. And what I'd like to do now, in the spirit of it, is actually focus on my journey into the autobiographical documentary, because I was an extremely unwilling agent, both behind the camera and certainly in front of the camera more than anything. So I am from a Hasidic background, as I mentioned, and when I broke out, which is a whole other story, when I left, or slipped, depending on how one looks at it, I didn't leave behind the certain thematics, certain tropes in my education, such as the self-examination, the constant self-consciousness that a religious life, a life of faith, requires. That's constantly there. And that self-examination can be both a burden, which is not necessarily negative, because you feel it and you know it's there and it's hard to forget. It's the reason we carry certain things around so we don't forget we have to do something. And it's not terribly different with culture, pieces of culture, costume, food, etc. But the other thing it also is, it can be freeing, because you can, like a turtle to some degree, go back into that house that could be very private, like in my case, because I don't live in a Hasidic neighborhood. For me, it's where I go in my mind, and specifically me, my creative mind. It's both torturous, you know, with this new documentary I'm doing, that, you know, I was just talking to a friend today, and I'm struggling so much with doing this documentary film about Hasidic Williamsburg. And I said, but I have to give a lecture tonight about the auto documentary. And he goes, great, talk about that. The struggle, it's very real. And you will hear Agnes Varda talk about that too. Because the internal can be so dark and so difficult, and at the same time, very freeing for that reason. So back to my story. So I take those pieces of the culture, of cultural, I guess for lack of a better term, because it is a relationship, potlatch with me. You know, you don't take something and go. There's a give and take. You know, remember, I left. So there's a give and take. I had to lose something in exchange. And what I lost was what we call the insider. Because now I'm not the insider. What am I? Say it again. The outsider. And you've... Is that your final answer? I'm actually, that's great, because from their perspective, I am a very clearly defined outsider. But what am I really? An insider outsider. And if you're going to come into my community, you're a what? I would say you're probably an outsider. But if you've studied, if you have some kind of background or interest, you might almost become an outsider insider. It depends. No one gets to define that but you. But to some degree, that is so, and not to a large degree, that's not true. Because you do get coined and crafted by the other. There's the self and the other. And the way that you get seen is the way you get crafted in that eye. And you have to deal with that story that just got created by the way you have been perceived, which goes on constantly with the camera in front and behind, whether you're making a story about yourself or you're making a story about someone else. So I take with me this already torn insider-outsider-ness, go to college, where I... where I was, you know, I've never been in a co-ed environment, so now I'm dealing with a co-ed environment. And a place where it actually matters, what I have to say intellectually, So I have this kind of feminist enlightenment and get really into literary criticism, which is a nice blending of what? Don't tell anyone I said this, but Talmud and literature. Because there's a teaching, which is what? Kenelcha Rav. Get for yourself a, literally, rabbi, but also teacher. You guys know what this means. Oh, he's doing what I said to do earlier, which is smile and sort of have your own thoughts, because you have a full hour to kind of meditate, which is great. So you get for yourself this teacher, i.e. guide, and what I did with the literature I was reading is I approached it with a Talmudic, even though I was never brought up with Talmud because I'm a girl, but a Talmudic eye, always wondering what. What's the wonder? What are you constantly looking at when you're looking at a text from a Talmudic perspective? Many things, but what's one of them that might be relevant? Schnell. Nothing? No guesses. Who wrote it? Who am I listening to? And you get that immediately when you pick up an autobiographical film. You don't have to wonder, who made this film? What were they really trying to tell me? Of that you have to wonder anyway. But what are, you know, who are the funders? Who are the producers, that is? What were they trying to push? Was it the father-son relationship, and that's why it got funded? We talked about this earlier today. Or, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know who it is. It's right there in front of you. So that's probably another reason I entered that world. That was all unintentional. Instead, I get a Fulbright to go to Hungary and collect Hasidic stories. It was an ethnography, by the way, not a folklore, that I was at NYU. Where's Jeff? Oh, yes, good, you're there. So it was in ethnography. And what I was doing was going to collect the quote-unquote last Yiddish Hasidic stories that are being told in situ, meaning in the location where they had been told 50 years earlier at Hasidic events. And you'll see scenes of that in Divan. Not of the interviews, sorry, but of the tish, the court that the rabbi holds around the table and people sit around and actually tell stories. What's the most important part of a story? Come on, there's so many elements, you could be shouting anything. The main character. Now that she said outsider, she's not going to say anything. Most important part of the story. Just so you know, they're recording it, but I get to edit it later so I can edit these quiet moments. The immediate response from the audience. What? The moral, that's good. The credits. Spoken like a true filmmaker. The most important part of the story, and you probably knew this instinctively, is the listener. Because we can sit in it and some vant, as we say in Yiddish. You could sit and talk to the wall, and it doesn't really matter that you told the story. You can sit and make a film about anything you want. If it stays in your editing room, this is my own message to myself today, but if it stays in the editing room, you have not really told the story. The most important part of the story is the listener, not so much the teller. In that relationship, what happened was I brought a camera into the room totally by chance. I brought a little cheap analog Hi-8 camera into the room as a field research tool to ask my quote-unquote subjects, I hate that word, to ask the people that were telling me stories to tell me stories. Who were they telling the story to? What? The camera! All of a sudden, as my grandfather would say, hastige hätte sonst. Could you ever have imagined this? That's not literally what it means to them, as you know. But they were speaking to whom? An object. But they weren't speaking to the listener of the actual camera. Who were they speaking to? What is the imagined presence of a camera in a room?
An audience.
And that is a whole group of listeners, far more attractive than me in a room. You know, maybe they wanted to set me up with their sons or grandsons, depending on how old they thought I was, but the interest in me ended there. You know, if they were going to tell a story, they turned to the camera, and in so doing, they also adjusted their costumes, as you might call it. They ran and found a yarmulke that was sitting on the bottom of a pile in the corner of a room somewhere and put it on their heads. Women would literally take doilies, well, one did, off the top of her television set from under her alarm clock and shake out the dust and put it on her head. It just rushes the ritual. A memory around it, almost physical memory around it, just rushed back. And that dynamic turned me on so much. And I just knew that this is the place that I want to be in terms of the relationship of the Hasidic world that I came from and what I got out of it, which is that constant interaction, troubled or otherwise. And I tell you all of this in the context of something that was written by a woman named Anna Wieworka, who is a Polish philosopher slash writer. Do you know who she is? She did this work on Holocaust testimonies. And I remember reading this when I was gathering these stories and thinking about how I'm going to examine them, and in the end make my argument that the last Hasidic story was actually the story of the survivor, that new Hasidic stories weren't being told even in Borough Park or Williamsburg. And I might still be right about that, though I didn't go all the way with now collecting stories in Hasidic Williamsburg, but I personally haven't heard stories about miracles after the war, so that would be something to think about, and if you know them, please share them with me. So what I had found her say is that the communal I in Yiddish, which is what? Ich, in testimony. She was very specific. She said in Holocaust testimony is, I mean, the word I in Yiddish, sorry, I just blew my punchline, is communal. That if a person sits in front of you and says, and then I survived this ghetto, and then I went to such and such a camp, and then I saw the following horrid scene, and I couldn't believe genocide was going on right before my very own eyes. Of course, I didn't know that at the time. And then this happened. You're listening to a communal narrative, even though you're getting an eye. Now, think back to documentaries you've seen by either Ross McElwee or anyone you've seen who's done a documentary about the self. If you haven't, and Agnes Varda talks about this, if she has not made you feel, if you haven't had that Aristotelian response, as Aristotle writes about this, this is the point, this is what makes theater work, apparently. That's what he thought. I agree. If you have not had that communal moment with the eye in the film, it probably didn't work on you. And, you know, that's one of the most difficult parts about turning the camera onto yourself if you're trying to tell a story. There's nothing wrong with doing a self-documentary for yourself, which this gentleman was talking about, which is very useful in the learning process. So, I've given you some pieces here. The question of I, the question of where you come from. We're talking about uprooting, taking the two steps back and uprooting where you came from. There is within that, so I discussed with you the Yiddish, the I, within the Hasidish, us, we, what we survived, meaning I. But on top of that, place the Hasidish ritual of Shrayim. Who here knows what Shrayim is? Now I know at least one of you does, but who that I don't immediately know knows? What is Shrayim, or Shirayim? Okay, Dov Bero, what is it? That's right, you're correct. It is the leftovers on the Rebbe's plate. I'm now describing the ritual mixed in with the definition. It literally means leftovers. But it's the leftovers on the Rebbe's plate that he blesses as if it is his own. He blesses this big plate full of kugel or whatever, takes a piece for himself, and the leftovers, conveniently his Rebbetzin, his wife, has made a huge piece of kugel for him in front of him. The leftovers, which were intended for him, he hands out to the community. Now think about, metaphorically, what that says to you about the world you come from, and the little pieces that we grab even from our intellectual pursuits, or whatever they might be, the Shirayim that you take with you, and you move it forward. What makes it holy? Why is this blessing the Rebbe made on such a material piece, item? What is the exact thing that made it holy? So go back to the metaphor. What exact thing made this item Shirayim worthy? And this really ties in very strongly with the idea of material culture, for those of you who study that. So what I want to do is, with that, introduce Agnes Varda. Think about Shirayim. Watch this. There's a couple minutes clip I want you to watch, and then we will talk about the connection between what she is talking about in her auto vision and then this Hasidic notion of Shirayim. So let me see if I can do this without too much ado. Actually, that means, Jeffrey, can you come in and help me? So, are there any questions so far about something I might have just said quickly, which is very possible? No? Okay. Do you need a little intro on Agnes Varda? She was a fiction filmmaker, she is, and she's better known in some circles anyway for her nonfiction. There's word, if you read certain things about her, essays or whatever, you might find it attributed to her, this kind of French New Wave. The idea that you can represent the, how would you describe French New Wave? You probably do better at this than me. You're the theoretician.
Just talk about it as a movement emerging, in the early mid-60s.
It's okay if we don't.
It's far more, it's a personal set of fiction taking the camera out to the world, trying to counter some of the dominant conventions.
She experimented a lot with the subject, who's really the subject.
But not to take your focus off now from the idea of Shirayim, and not in her fictional work, this focus on the self, on subject, but in her personal work. And this is the one she's most noted for, although she has amazing other works, which just don't get enough clout or, enough attention.
J'ai comme plein âge. L'année s'est ramassée après la moisson. Glaneur, glaneuse, celui ou celle qui glane. Autrefois, il s'agissait toujours de glaneuses, et les plus célèbres peintes par milliers étaient reproduites dans le dictionnaire. L'original est au musée d'Orsay.
L'année, c'est l'esprit d'un danse. J'ai entendu souvent ma mère dire « Fini de ramasser pour pas gaspiller !» Maintenant, malheureusement, ça se fait plus parce qu'il y a des machines tellement performantes. Mais avant, oui, j'ai eu de l'année avec mes voisines, avec le blé, comme le riz aussi se faisait avant. Eh bien, j'avais mon grand allié, hein. On glanait, on ramassait le blé, les épis, les beaux épis qu'il y avait. Une journée au soleil, quand il y a des bestioles qui vous piquent, des moustiques, c'est pas trop agréable, mais en fait, ça nous plaisait. Le soir, on était fourbus et on rentrait avec nos sacs, nos tabliers. Et après, c'était une bonne partie de rire, de boire, du café, vous voyez, voilà. Je suis née là, dans ce mars, et j'y mourrai.
Pas tout de suite, allez, on va les y retourner. Merci beaucoup, madame.
Merci à vous, messieurs, dames. Je ne suis pas confuse parce que là, vous m'avez eu.
Ah oui, je me souviens toute l'année. Parce que moi, je me rappelle de ça quand j'allais faire ça avec ma grand-mère et mes frères et mes sœurs.
Dans un temps, on le faisait déjà, ils le ramassaient parce qu'il n'y avait pas à manger pendant la guerre. Ils allaient taper du grain, ils faisaient de la farine.
I mean, we can keep watching this film. I'd be fine with that, actually. She was one of my earliest inspirations. Just that first moment in the film took care of that for me. But as you continue through the film, she takes a journey from that moment where you're immediately driven into the approach to her narrative as the poetic. Almost anything she says, I don't know if you've done this, but I did it right away. You can say, oh my God, that's about culture, or oh, that's about my past. That's about, you know, yes, it's difficult. The gnats and the mosquitoes are biting away, but I'm going to bend down and I'm going to lift up these leftovers and make it work. Someone else's trash is someone else's treasure. You know, and all of a sudden it starts to build and all of these layers get created, but all she's doing is giving you the history of gleaning in France, you know. And eventually she turns the camera on herself, and I wish there was a way I could see where that happens, but we could take the chance and just play it through. Yeah, it's like 2 or 3 minutes later. So if you'll indulge me, we can keep listening to these lovely people talk about gleaning in France. But so add, and don't forget the Chassidim.
Maintenant, on grappille plus, on glane plus pour manger.
We no longer glean to eat.
Si le glanage est d'un autre âge, le geste est inchangé dans notre société qui mange à satiété. Glaneurs agricoles ou urbains, ils se baissent pour ramasser. Il n'y a pas de honte, il y a du tracas, du désarroi.
Abdoré-tu. C'est ça. Se baisser, mais heureusement, pas s'abaisser. Mais je dois t'avouer, quand je les vois se pencher, j'ai le cœur blessé. Ça fait mal de les voir récupérer pour se nourrir. Obligé de ramasser de la nourriture, même en train de courir, courir dans les marchés. Pour manger ce que les gens jettent, une guesse qui peut encore rester, même les restes, ils récupèrent ce qui a nos yeux la plus de valeur, et ramassent par terre, et avant les balayeurs. Pour nous, un bien peut-être pour eux beaucoup, ils font le tour des quartiers pour assouvir leur faim parce qu'ils en ont besoin. Hier comme aujourd'hui, il y a encore pour demain, les faits des gestes seront les mêmes, les restes seront leurs gains.
À la ville comme à la campagne, hier comme aujourd'hui, c'est toujours le même geste modeste de glaner. Mais de nos jours, il n'y a pas que des glaneuses. Il y a des glaneurs. Ce que j'ai remarqué en les filmant, c'est que chacun glane seul. Contrairement aux peintures d'autrefois, où on voyait toujours des groupes, rarement une glaneuse. En tout cas, il y en a une assez célèbre, c'est celle de Jules Breton, qui est au musée d'Arras. On a pris la route vers le nord. Il y avait des grands camions. Et ça, mais ça, je vais y revenir plus tard. Et on est arrivé dans la ville d'Arras, on a vu sa place, on a vu son musée, et la glaneuse de Jules Breton. L'autre glaneuse, celle du titre de ce documentaire, c'est moi. Je laisse volontiers tomber les épis de blé pour prendre la caméra. Ces nouvelles petites caméras, elles sont numériques, fantastiques, elles permettent des effets stroboscopiques, des effets narcissiques et même hyper réalistiques. Désespoir, ce n'est pas « ô vieillesse ennemie ». Ce serait peut-être même « vieillesse amie ». Et tout de même, il y a mes cheveux et mes mains qui me disent que c'est bientôt la fin. Bon, pour le moment, on roule vers la Beauce, réputée pour ses blés, mais c'est trop tard pour la moisson.
Yes.
Okay. So, I almost thought about this now in terms of positioning all these elements into the tish that I mentioned earlier. The Rebbe's tish, which is the court that the rabbi holds, and all these things that come to it. So the stories, which have the communal eye that you tell maybe about yourself or someone else. It's the individual person, but it's a more of a communal tale. And then there's the shirayim, which are the leftovers at this very same table. But while you're staying in the same place, i.e. in your seats, while you're watching a movie, what else are you also doing? You're moving, you're traveling, you're going on some kind of journey that this main character, and in this case, the auteur, the gleaner, is taking you. Now, you might be gleaning from her, but what is she gleaning from? Or I should first say, how is she gleaning, which she says, with her camera, but what is she gleaning from? I think the answer is it remains to be interpreted. But she also talks about her aging. So now we've got this other element of storytelling which has to do with picking your subject. Your subject can be yourself, and she keeps coming back to herself, her hands, her body. And she also becomes very political. I mean, she always is in her work. But the question becomes about what your subject of your film is going to become about. Now, if it is you, which we already talked about, is that enough? Why not? You need a couch. Thank you. What does that mean? You need a device. And in this case, I mean, it could be the camera, but the camera's not enough unless it's going to be about the camera. You need a device. And for lack of a better term, the device could be the subject that's up in question or the subject, the person. So either one could be your option. So if you take a look at Ross McElwee, for example, what was his subject supposed to be in Sherman's March? Who has seen Sherman's March? What was his subject supposed to be?
It was about Sherman's March through the South. It was him documenting.
And he raised money for this as well. Sherman's March through the South, he raised all this money that was going to support an educational documentary through his incredible eyes. What did it become? He basically tries to, very well put, Am I allowed to say that on tape? Fred's not happy. For him, it basically takes on the subject, which is slightly similar, if you ask me, of pillaging, I left out the first word, his way through the South, basically. And, you know, basically in search of a girlfriend. He basically whittles the time away on the grant, but as long as he keeps that camera rolling, he becomes the subject of the film. And what becomes the subject of the film is the substitution, his substitution journey. Whereas if we take the other meaning of the word subject, which is the person, you could also, in theory, if you, you know, someone's famous, or if you're famous and you want to do a film about yourself, that's a sell. I mean, that's enough of an interest. Why? Because you're already coming with previous history. That also works with someone who's historically known. But that's not usually the case if you're going to do an auto documentary. I mean, it might be, but it's not usually the case. So the next step would be to find somebody who you can interact with. You know, sometimes in script writing they say it's the, you know, the sidekick, the person who's the foil. And in my case, it was my father. And he was quite the unwilling in the end he was the protagonist, I was the antagonist. But he was quite the unwilling subject. And the question is that tension, is that an excuse to then be able to tell your own story? Or a way to be able to get away with telling your own story? I don't know if it necessarily worked in mine, because I think it was the couch that actually did it, the device, the talking stick. But in Alan Berliner's film, Nobody's Business, he actually interviews whom? His father. And his father absolutely does not want to be there. So I'm going to show you a clip from the beginning of that and throw that into the mix and then pull all these pieces together. But think about now the Tish. Now think about the Tish and the unwilling subject.
The story is told about a man who went to an artist and said, I want to have a picture made. The artist turned to him and said, look, there are two kinds of pictures. There's a portrait and a landscape. He said, well, which is cheaper? The artist said, the landscape. He said, well, can you make a landscape of me? Testing 1, 2, 3, testing 1, 2, 3. How long do you think this is going to take, Alan?
About an hour. Tell me about this picture. It looks like you're about to sing. It looks like you're about to sing or give a speech somewhere.
No, that's not so. I'm just posing.
For whom?
For what? I'm just posing for a picture to be taken.
There's no story behind the image?
Well, you want me to make up stories? Alan, before we go any further, let me tell you something. I'm just an ordinary guy who's living an ordinary life.
I was in the army. I got married. I raised a family. Worked hard. I had my own business.
That's all. Nothing to make a picture about.
Someone in the audience is watching right now and saying, why am I here watching this film about this guy?
I would ask too, because I don't know what the hell they're doing here. I'm being honest with you.
You should be honored.
I'm not.
Your life not only can be...
My life is nothing. My life is no different from I don't know how many billions of people. Who the hell would care about Oscar Berliner? Who the hell am I? You know, it's ridiculous.
Everyone has a life that has something special about it.
No.
Your life has nothing special?
No.
Nothing?
Look.
How could you be so convinced about that?
You're trying to make something of nothing.
You're my father. I have to do it. I need to do it.
You don't have to do it.
I have to do it.
You're going to do what you want to do, whether I want you to do it or I don't want you to do it. I'm telling you, you're wasting your time.
What's the matter?
Nothing. What happens now?
I just want to be open and honest right up front that I want to know everything there is to know about you and our family.
If it gives you satisfaction, be my guest.
Where are you from?
I'm from America. I'm born and raised in America. What else do you want to know?
No, you're the child of immigrants.
You know how many children have been against the Iran?
That's exactly right.
And each
one has a story. And they want to know your story.
Okay. Are you committed to that? I'm not. All I know is that my father came from Poland, my mother came from Russia, period, that's it.
Where in Poland?
Who the hell knows? My father never told me.
You never asked?
Of course not.
Who would know?
Well, nobody left but me, so who the hell would know?
Well, maybe I'll ask all the first cousins, maybe they'll know.
I know little, they know even less.
Russia. Do you know where in Russia?
No.
I was always told Russia and Poland.
And if they said where in Russia and Poland?
I have no idea.
No, I don't have the faintest idea of any details.
Basically Russia or Poland, the other side.
I would say Russia. Unfortunately, I don't have a whole lot of information in that regard.
Where is your mother's family from?
Germany.
Okay, and they say where in Germany?
I guess Berlin.
It's almost as if the history, for me, began here in the United States rather than in Europe.
I just never asked. I never asked. They never said.
I think I may have known at some point, but it's, it was not terribly important to me.
I don't know any of that history. You'd like to know it, though.
It would be interesting. I don't know how much of an effort I would expend to know it. Maybe you'll discover it for us.
Time, I do have to stop it. As much as I really don't want to, because usually when I do this, I show it all the way to the part where it's in another 5 minutes, but I think I have to end soon. Is that right? 45 minutes? It's an express, lecture express, which is fine by me. But usually I'll show it up to the part and then I'll tell you why, where actually Alan finds the history of his family, and he finds it in the records that you're about to see in Utah. And he presents it to his father. And who's seen this film? I know you have, Suzanne. You've never seen this film? Somebody fire that woman, okay? This, I'm gonna give you this to you. This is great. This is a film that you should show in all of your classes for whatever reason you want to. And I'm obviously expressing to you something that is one of the key elements of filmmaking, which is what? Passion. Who gives a hoot about what Alan's up to in this entire film? Alan. And that is what makes it an auto documentary. It's not even about him. It's about his family. It's not even about his family, the way that Sherman's March is not about Sherman's March, and the way that the Divan is not about the Divan. What is it about? Why tell stories? Why even turn the camera on to yourself? Why listen to a story? Sorry? It's the journey. It's his search. It's this constant struggle to know. And he shows you from the very beginning the problem. Most people don't want to know. But what Oscar Berliner says from the very beginning, I have taken with me as my rule of filmmaking, which is right now there's someone sitting in this room wondering, why the hell am I sitting here listening? And if you think that all the time in the editing room, I promise you, you will become mad. No, I promise you that that is a really good guide to why. And the answer has to come from some of the things that either occur to you as you were watching some of these people, and you should go and watch the full films of these two, and certainly Ross McKelvey's as well, and many, many others. But the reasons for me is about these elements that tie back, those two steps back or more, depending, to my Hasidic roots, which has to do, again, with making sure to put the story forth, the kugel in front of the Rebbe at the tish, giving it some kind of meaning, I guess the word in that case is the blessing, and then allowing there to be so much left over that there's plenty to glean from, whether it's what I intended or not. And then finally, think about the unwilling protagonist, and in my case, it's my father. Finally, who is the unwilling protagonist at this tish? Probably you, because you don't fit in. Or you're tired, or you don't really want to be there. So you will constantly need some thread that ties you back in. And whose responsibility is that? Whose responsibility is that? The instinct is the Rebbe's, right? The person who's running the court, running the evening, telling the stories. No. To some degree, it's true, but to a much larger degree, the listener is the most important part of the story. And that also means the listener has to take the responsibility. And if you don't, you have already decided, I don't belong here. And then there's nothing to do. You know, unless someone is going to show up like Alan Berliner and put a camera in your face and say, but there was, and here's what I'm going to do about it. You know, so with my father, a way to put it is, he, along with the rest of his community, have decided they do not belong where? In the quote-unquote outside world, in secular life, or in non-religious or non-faith-based life. So I come along with my camera and I'm like, but what if I'm not? You know, so this film, this auto-documentary, which, by the way, I never wanted to make. I was doing a film about Hasidic storytelling. And I'm still going to explore that possibility with the Ahaim archives. And we're struggling with the same things I struggled with when I started. Where's the verite? Where's the stuff? Where's the drama that's going to pull people in so that we can get away with teaching them about storytelling? Or we can even get away with telling them Hasidic stories. And in so doing, in so trying to do that film, I ended up with 200 hours of footage. And for those of you who were there last night, I'm about to repeat myself. My editor and I had to go through all 200 hours after it was shot because we decided that this film, she decided, that this film had to be about me. And again, I use that term very lightly, about me, and I hope that you walk away with the same confusion I have about what that really means, auto-documentary, okay? And the idea that I now have to go through this footage and find myself in almost every shot and try and put together this entire film. If you watch it, you'll see 77 minutes of a person going through a journey trying to reconnect with her father through the story of this couch, apparently. Okay, and what it's really about is authenticity and trying to fit in and belonging. So that kind of drama, that conflict, that taking you back, that insider-outsider-ness, which we all have a piece of, becomes the most important tool to press the on button of the camera, I think, for me. And that might make me the auto-documentarian or, as I said earlier, the narrative filmmaker inspired by the documentary work that I will struggle to become. I'm going to end this on a piece from the Divan Extras. So I'm just going to blow it for you, for those who haven't seen the film. And either I'll blow it or I'll create another layer for you because hopefully, once you find out that, in fact, the couch I do get is not the real couch, boom, she did it. And that in life you never get the real couch. You always have to find a substitute and a flea market find, and then you'll understand why I love Agneshvara and the whole idea of finding your stuff that defines you in a leftover bin. And I think some of us have that in us already. This kind of, what was I saying? Oh, yes. So that story actually ends with me not getting the couch, which was the point. But it also brings me and my father much closer, so that all these trips I took back to my great-grandfather's house in Hungary on my own was one kind of experience, and very lonely, even though I was surrounded by the ghosts and the desire to keep looking back. This time I actually go back with my father and my brothers after they knew what I was up to, after they fully see, as you know, for lack of a better term, I've come out to them as a secular person and not a Hasidic person, which I'm sure is obvious to you, but I don't dress this way when I go there. After the coming out session, though I'm straight, and after realizing that it's really not about the real thing, the real couch, we end up going back to the real house to see what happened to the house with the couch that used to be in it. So I'm going to play you that to end and to pull together all of these strands of the communal voice, okay, the tish, the shrayim, the leftovers, and the journey that might take along with it an unwilling subject, meaning a subject you didn't intend, or an unwilling subject, a person you didn't intend, or you did intend, but they didn't intend to be there. And those are the three pieces that should come to light in this moment. So,
better way to make up for the loss of the couch than to visit our great-grandfather's house together.
Last name was not Greek. Her last name was Glick. He did not know his family name. He called himself Adam David. And her name was Glick to find the Kaloha.
So we're like from a feminist family?
Yeah, family. Here we go. Here we go.
How much do you want to bet? This is with Barclay.
That's how you lost the couch. You never sold the green couch.
Uh-huh.
I bet you the couch is still there.
I'm sorry, is this the house? I couldn't hear you. Papi, is this the house or not?
Nobody lives here.
Do you give me a look? Do you just call me a
look?
No, but don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it.
Don't do it.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it.
Don't do
it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it.
Who's Yeshua?
Don't know. Do you need Zadistan? Do you need Zadistan?
Khan, what's the little girl Khan?
Zadistan, you're
ocean. Oh, no. Oh, you can't kill them.
Okay, I'll have to take them. Let them go.
There's 200 hours of footage, cut down to 77 minutes.
By the way, that's Zelda Greenstein, the editor, beside me. So I think that the question to maybe end on is, could this trip with them even have happened had I not picked up the camera and turned it on the quote-unquote story of the couch, which then became a story of my relationship with my father. And one can ask that question, finding the linchpin in almost any film that'll pull it out and create that burst that we're looking for. If you can find that linchpin in any film, you can ask that question to any auto documentary film. I would argue any film, because I'm the kind of person who believes a director's always telling his story, even if it's quote-unquote narrative. But let's just leave it with the auto documentary and end on that story. And one can even say with me, I mean, how obsessed am I with Hasidism? I made my entire lecture a Hasidish tish. You know? So this is the kind, you know, some might say that people have only one story to tell and they keep telling it over and over again. And I actually don't see a problem with that. So with that, I'd like to end, and thank you very much for having me and allowing me to do, as we say in Yiddish, the art form of dreikop, to twist the head. Question.
Have your father and brothers seen the film, and how has your relationship with your father changed?
Okay, so for those of you who heard me answer this yesterday, I ask you to forgive me, because I'm about to repeat it, because it is the truth, and therefore I say it again, though it gets told differently, hopefully, every now and then. But I've been given talking points by my distributor when the film first came out. No, it's not true. It's too small a film. Okay. My father saw the film the night before I went to do what's called onlining. Do you know what that is? That's like basically printing it. And that means that I didn't really leave too much margin for him saying, I'm out of this film. So either I really trusted him, or I was willing to take a really high risk. Plus, knowing that he and I are very similar, which is the great irony of all of this, I myself didn't want to be in the film, and I, kind of gave in a little. So, I mean, or a lot, as you might say. But I actually cannot sit and watch my film, and haven't in a very long time. But because of that same, that where was that gentleman who liked the idea of turning a camera onto himself? He is gone, probably because he's turning a camera onto himself. But I personally am not comfortable with that. So, by the way. So, I kind of felt a little bit of camaraderie with him on that. But that was not the first thing on my mind. The first thing on my mind was the fact that, as I said earlier, I was basically coming out to my father. Because he has never seen me in pants and might have heard rumors. He does not know that I'm not Orthodox. And on top of that, I'm about to make it a public tale to some degree. Even though I don't spell it out in the film, and until recently, I never said it publicly. I'm not Orthodox. I never liked answering that question. And now, somehow, it doesn't, you know, irk me in the same way. I guess we all move, we change, you know, as life goes on. And so, and then on top of that, he had become one of the main characters. And what I forgot to mention earlier, in terms of that subject that you work against or with, that foil character, makes it even clearer who you are. I mean, it's that kind of the Longinus theory of you are what you're not. You're not, you know, you're not what you are. You know what I mean? So this is green because it's not purple. So being with that foil character is what you're not. So, or that's what you're oh so much more of. Wow. You know, perfect. They'll get along, but they don't. You know. So it, that kind of, you know, there was my father with me, neither of us wanted to be in the story, but he was actually the person who I left behind, and I was trying to get closer to. Did you see the film? You did, so it's okay that I'm telling you this. Okay, so, that's not being prepared. Anywho, so we're sitting there. Oh, and later on top of that, just to make it even more scary, is that we don't, my time's up. Oh my God, can someone pop that thing out? That's terrible. I'm like stuck in, oh my, was that what you were looking at the whole time? So embarrassing. Blue is much better. So layer on top of that, the fact that the community doesn't support filmmaking or the kind of media at all, you know, unless it's specific for learning, and even then you may as well just sit and learn. It's called what we call Bitzelsmann, it's a waste of time. So, you know, already I'm kind of wasting my time being a filmmaker, let alone making a film. Okay. So then enter the room with this project in hand and showing it to my father. So a lot of things were in my mind when I showed it to him. I tried very hard to be relaxed so that I could kind of help create that energy in the room, but I did not succeed. But what I did do is I asked him to watch it all the way through and not stop at any point. And once again, I'll repeat what I said yesterday, which is that, and you probably know this, in a story, you need your beginning, your middle, your end, and the beginning is usually setting up a problem. It either does or doesn't work out by the end. You know, the Arthurian story does or doesn't get to work. And to problematize the community is very painful for my father to see. Now, in the end, and you haven't seen it, but and what I hope, and from what I've understood, it works to some degree. There's a great love that I have for the world that I come from, even though I complicate it a bit. You know, in the same way, what I said earlier, I'm doing with this Polish-Jewish interaction that happens in Williamsburg in the 1990s. You know, this, it's, you know, a little shocking, bizarre, but I also don't dislike my community for creating it, and they also didn't create it all by themselves, you know. So, you know, creating this problem in the beginning of Ivan could, of course, be taken the wrong way. And if you stop it at that point, you will not understand what I was trying to do in the film, meaning he would. So he did see the film, and he didn't hate it, or, you know, maybe he's, you know, he's a very loving father. I have to be very lucky. A lot of the people in my film who have sat with Ivan and tell their stories were not treated that way necessarily by their parents, and some of them have been shut out or, you know, being, one of them is gay, so it's absolutely totally unwelcome. And in fact, when my father's, at the time he was married to this woman who was like the kind of person who wanted to invite everyone over for Shabbos, you know, for a meal, she goes, let's get all those people on the couch over for Shabbos. And my father's like, give me a break. And she goes, no, I'll do it. And he goes, but isn't that one gay? Well, I don't want her in my house. And you know, I could feel your response in the room right now. But I get it. I totally get where he's coming. I'm not making it okay. And from that place, you could start to educate, that middle place. You can't expect people to meet you halfway if you're not coming halfway too. Period. End of sentence. So if you don't hear where that kind of thing is coming from, okay, I'm dealing with my father, I already know he's an amazing guy. I'm not in a dangerous situation with like either anti-Semitism or racism facing me, or, you know, homophobia facing me in a scary, unknown place. It's my father. I know how to talk to him about this. So, you know, it doesn't always work in conflict resolution. But in this case, I knew what I was dealing with. So that's when I was able to actually talk to him. There was a platform. And the film became a platform. You know, not to the issues of inviting my lesbian friend over for Shabbos, which I did anyway, but a platform for discussing some of these more typical, I mean, these more difficult subjects of, you know, no, I'm not married at 18, I'm not even married at 34, you know, and how many times do I have to hear, I could have had 5 grandchildren from you already by now. And we all hear this in different cultures, but, you know, I also hear it, you know, and so, you know, it's a constant unfulfilled expectation that is already built into the fact that we're different. It's not even a parental thing. You know, oh yeah, everyone's, you know, parents, you know, so. This is like a case of, just by definition of who we are, an unfulfilled expectation. You know, and it's no one's fault. You know, and it's hard to see it that way because, you know, there's this idea that as the father, you're responsible to make sure that your kids get the schus, you know, the merits of their lives and of yours, and of your grandparents and your great-grandparents. And if you don't do that, who's to blame? From a faith-based place. If you believe, then you already believe you're in trouble. If you don't believe, well, hey, you know, you can look at it from a more psychological place or sociological place. Or, so in terms of my father, that was that. My brothers are, you know, you met, you just saw them. So they're more into the kind of teasy place. As long as I don't fully interfere with their lives, we're fine. You know, they're actually much cooler than I thought they were. You know? And there's a longer story I told yesterday about one of my brothers, so someone should tell him later about how I got out of a lawsuit. No, there was never a lawsuit. He just said he would sue. There was another hand that I saw. Yes?
How did brother also do a documentary about, like, finding people with the same name as him?
Yes, just the one right after this one.
Which I feel is kind of related to this theme, because he's kind of discovering the other selves, but the point is that they're probably different from him. So I'm wondering about film as a kind of classic theory of film, you know, as strange as people. To what extent does film mystify yourself to yourself?
I don't know this in a general way, so I'm going to be careful to answer this very specifically to what I know. I'm always amazed by what I see in the editing room versus what I see through the camera, for example, so it's already one layer change in the mystification process. And then when you start cutting it together, you enter the zone. For those of you who edit, you know, I think you know what I'm talking about. It's like, you know, the material presents itself to you, and then you become even more and more foreign, especially if the film's about you. Which is why I absolutely don't understand how Alan Berliner cuts his own films. He cut Nobody's Business. You know, he has this way of crafting himself. I think Ross McElroy cuts his own films. Does anyone know this for a fact?
Yes.
I think he does too. I went mad trying to cut a film about my community, let alone about myself. I didn't cut this movie. You know, I honestly have no idea how people can do it. I mean, I understand that the process of turning the camera on yourself, you're already crafting yourself. And as the director, you know what you do or don't want to happen with your work, minus all those levels of, oh, well, that's cool. Well, that's interesting. Oh, I guess I can tell it this way. You know, and the power of the image. It's like, whoo. I mean, you start layering it, and then you add this particular kind of music, and then all of a sudden you throw in someone saying something underneath, and then you added a whole other meaning to it. And the dimensions keep popping up and going, you know, I don't know if you know about this, what is it called, Leshen Kylin? How would you define Leshen Kylin? It's lead, right? It's heated up lead that you then pour into a pot, right?
Coals.
Is it coals, though? No, we didn't do it with coals. We did it
with water on hot coals.
No.
It's lead.
It's a basket of wood.
It was with what?
It's a, you know, it's a folk medicine.
It's a folk medicine, but I'm talking about the actual, I think it's the lead that when you pour it, it comes into all these like weird shapes. What?
But you know it's totally different from what we know from the
Tell media. Me about it.
We should interview you.
What's that?
We'll interview
you. You have to interview me. Okay, yes, yeah, that's a great idea. Anyway, so the reason I bring this up is because these things just kind of pop out. All these dimensions kind of pop out and add all these new meanings to what you once thought was this kind of story. So that does happen. I definitely learned about myself through this. And I learned about people around me, which also,
you know, particularly my father, which, as Alan says to his father, you know, my father, I have to do this. I have to know. You know, so there's that relationship. Am I understanding your question?
Well, I guess I'm wondering to what extent you're... I mean, when you call that documentary, his name to himself just became more and more mysterious and complex.
Well, I think this is the whole question there was, what's in a name? How does a name define you?
So I guess I'm wondering to what degree the narrative that you're telling about yourself is one of kind of disclosing the bottomlessness of yourself.
I'm sure it could get that way, like where you go, okay, so what is me and what, you know, what is my identity? You know, I was very determined to get away with the narrative structure. So I didn't go to that place where it just bores deeper and deeper and deeper down to this question of who am I? That was not my structure at all. My structure was, okay, girl decides to make good with dad. You know, I used that, you know, not even the couch actually. I used that as my device. Girl decides to make good with dad by getting him X, in this case a couch. Goes to find the thing, can't, has to come up with another way to reconnect. So I forced that deeper question of who am I, who am I, who am I, where do I come from? How do I look back into the world that I came from, move forward with the pieces that I decided to take with me, and am I even allowed to do that? So all those questions of the next generation and how we pass on our story and keep it as authentic as possible, whatever that might mean, you know, I authored that, the authority of that was the idea that I was going to have a beginning, middle, and end. I didn't go to that place, and actually, if you like that, Ross McElwee does go to that place. I mean, almost all of his pieces just keep boring deeper and deeper into the meaning of self. You know, Agnes Varda does it in one moment. When she looks at her hand, or she brushes her hair, there's a collage. You know, it's like, just that moment alone is, you know, I maybe I'm too scared to go there visually. You know, I don't know if I'm that documentary filmmaker. I do like to tell stories. And they have to have meaning to them, and you can, you know, the one film I did do of this length, the meaning was attached to what does it mean to try and connect with your roots, with your father in particular. You know, even, you know, by definition, as I said earlier, you don't. Yeah. Is that feeling of it? Yeah, I didn't connect with that film that Alan made as much as I connected with. I mean, this film I can watch about 1,000 times a day. Just, you know, this is an amazing work for me. And again, we all have to find our connection into this work. And The Gleaners and I, another one, like some people will fall asleep during this film, which is fine. But I can watch this over and over again. Yeah.
But I was thinking when I was watching Yvonne, in fact, that that's one of the things that's interesting about the film is the way in which you're always kind of receding. We only just get, there are two things. First of all, you're always receding. You're always kind of hard to capture. We get some moments with you.
You kind of make me cry.
Because
it's true.
But yeah, we get the moment on the train where we get that side shot that stays on for a while. But then most of the time, like, you're really hard to find. And it seems like that's one of the things when you're talking about the responsibility of the audience that, you know, I was trying to think about that decision, why you're doing it. Some level it was like, all right, she doesn't like being in front of the camera.
That's definitely true.
So
Well, the other reason is very literal, which is you did not shoot this as a film about me when we started.
Right.
So you have found some of the evidence.
Right.
Of it.
Well, that's
a real struggle.
The other thing I was wondering about.
But there's another reason.
The other reason that I was wondering about is that, your DP is male, and I was wondering if there were a lot of times when the male had access to certain things. And a very good DP, by the way.
Thank you. I would tell him that. There were two. The director of photography. Okay, the third reason is because I am interested in the possibility that I might have mistaken what I thought I was seeing as what quote unquote happened. So I was giving you the point of view, and then you make of that. Mm-hmm. And obviously, to some degree, I am manipulating what you make of it because I've got the soundtrack underneath.
Yeah.
And I put it in between such and such a moment, and because I've only shown you XYZ. And you know, you don't really know what's happening around the frame, and once you're framing, you're already making a beginning, middle, after. You know, you're always crafting. But that was one reason I did that. You know, but I think I came to that reason, and in conflict, there's always that grain of discovery. I came to that because I had the conflict of not having shot a film that was supposed to be autobiographical. I am not like Ross McElwee, and I admire it greatly, the ability to have the camera in your family. That camera is always there.
He's not in front of it. Only in Sherman's March does he get in front of it and speak to the camera. Yeah, it's not just
that's true. That's true.
Well,
same
he does
thing.
It in that way. Yeah.
Yeah, but you feel like
it's also creep. I mean, there's a creepiness to it. I mean, where part of you is always feeling like, oh my god, if I had to live with this person, I would kill him.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, the camera's always on. You know, documenting all of these incredibly personal moments.
And to some degree, I feel like I'm not a good filmmaker because my camera isn't always on. You know.
I mean,
I don't have that different relationship.
Yeah, yeah, but I don't. I mean, I would definitely not go with not a good filmmaker because of it. That's not your project.
Wait, no, I understand. But you know, as I'm saying this, I realize now that actually the times I wish I had a camera is always when there's tension.
Yeah.
When there's tension, I'm like, oh my god, where's the camera?
Yeah.
You know?
Sometimes when it's boring, you create a little tension.
Yes, that's true. How did you know that? Yes. So, yeah, no, I think that's interesting. That's the first time someone's actually mentioned that. I've barely seen it at all.
Have you seen The Grizzly Man?
The Grizzly, I did. Wow. I just see The Grizzly Man. Why?
Well, I was thinking about that the film, basically, he's filming himself. Mm-hmm. And then when he dies, somebody takes over. And the film becomes different point of view. Because the family is being interviewed. So a very autobiographical film turns biography.
Yeah, and the parts that I liked were, I mean, I understood that Werner Herzog actually edited it. I was watching his film, but the parts that I liked was when I was not watching his film. I love Herzog, don't get me wrong, but, you know, it was like, you know, but that's a different, that's interesting. I wish in a way you would have mentioned that in the middle of the lecture, because that's another form of witness, the earlier part of what I was talking about, the witness, because that's extreme witness. You know, what's the guy with the alligator who ends up dying because of, yeah, I mean, that extreme witness, I mean, we've made reality shows out of that. You know, not to minimize it in any way, but, you know, that's true. And then it takes on a different identity. It becomes biographical. That's the word. Yes. That reminds me of Barbara Meyerhoff, actually. What's the name of the film where she, it's not Number of Days, or maybe it is, where she is doing a documentary about aging in Jewish life in California, and then she ends up finding out she has cancer, and starts to engage in some of these rituals, like wig wearing, that Orthodox women are doing in the community. Now she has to wear one. And then she dies before the end of the film. And Vikram Jayanti, actually, was one of the producers on that film. He did When We Were Kings. And he convinced her, before she died, to keep the camera rolling. And he promised that he would make sure the film gets made at the very end. And that is an incredibly powerful film, because actually in that film there are no quote-unquote biographical elements. It remains autobiographical to the very end, which is just, I mean, even thinking about it brings tears to my eyes. It's an incredible film, and actually that would have been a great thing to show tonight as well, in terms of, you know, the witness, but also who crafts your tale. She trusted Vikram, you know, and whoever had taken it from him to finish it. So that's another example along The Grizzly Man. Anyway, thanks. Thanks for sticking around. I feel like we should party.